We live in an increasingly networked world. We hear this all the time, but most often when we think about our connections in this world, we think about our personal connections, our professional connections, we think about our connections in the cloud and to technology. I want to talk to you about a different set of connections today, a set of connections that have been around for at least 10,000 years, and who over that time have grown exponentially in diversity, complexity, and scale. These connections are our connections to infrastructure and the connections between the component parts of infrastructure. Infrastructure is increasingly all around us. It enables us to extract resources. It's tied to the pollution we emit into the environment and how we remediate some of that pollution. It's correlated with many socioeconomic indicators. And so it's closely tied to some of our greatest challenges, our challenges of climate change, poverty, biodiversity loss, economic competition. So to deal with these challenges, we must deal with the challenges to infrastructure. And quite simply, that challenge is that infrastructure is at risk. It is at risk continuously, constantly, and increasingly so. Now, to do something about this, we need to do three things. We need to see infrastructure for what it is, what its role is. We need to grasp how it works and how that relates to the risks that it faces. And then we need to act appropriately. To start with, we need a shared understanding of what infrastructure is. Most often we think of roadways and power lines and water mains, and that's hard infrastructure, that's one component of it, but it also includes soft infrastructure, things like healthcare, police, emergency services. So that constitutes what it is. But what is the role of infrastructure in our lives? I want to share with you a story about how I used to think of the role of infrastructure and how that relates to how we've dealt with the risk to infrastructure. When I was a kid, I remember every summer getting into the car with my family to go on our summer vacation. We'd take the same trip each year, and my parents would tell me this story about how when they took this trip as kids, they didn't take the same multi-lane highway that we were taking. They took a series of country roads. And the lesson was that their trip took a lot longer when they were kids than it will take now or when I was a kid. But I realized sometimes later that there was another lesson, and that lesson was that the infrastructure that they took compared to the infrastructure that I took also defined and establish some of the experiences they had along the way. They would see different scenery, they would take different stops, they would meet different types of people at those stops. So in a sense, infrastructure gives definition to our lives. It defines our experiences. And if you think of somebody who lives in the downtown of a major city, this city is supported by infrastructure. It's only possible because of infrastructure. So to some sense, how we can come to see ourselves as an urbanite is because infrastructure is allowing that. It's allowing us to define ourselves that way. So to say that infrastructure is at risk is also to say that some of the things that give our life definition, some of the things we care deeply about, are also at risk. And when we care about things and they're at risk, we tend to do one thing. We tend to try to protect that thing. And this is certainly what we've done with infrastructure. We've made it harder, stronger, more secure. We've spent almost $100 billion a year on this. But increasingly, as we focus solely on protection, that protection is failing. A couple years ago in New York City, a massive substation flooded due to Superstorm Sandy. A few years before that, the levees in New Orleans broke, bringing untold devastation. closer to home in Toronto, where this talk is taking place, we saw our power lines go down to ice storms last year. We've had roadways flood out, trains stranded. So if our mechanism for dealing with our risks to infrastructure isn't working, what do we do? We need to take a step back and reconsider. Now, I remember when this happened for me. I was working with my supervisor one day, and he said these words. He says, infrastructure has a purpose. Now, we were talking about how to bring an operation back up to a desirable level after a catastrophe, after infrastructure fails. This could be a hospital or an entire city or a company or infrastructure itself. And the basic idea was that even though there's been a catastrophe, even though the infrastructure has failed, its reason why it was there has not gone away. We still need to eat, we still need to drink water, we still need to run our businesses. You see, infrastructure more fundamentally is here to serve us. It does serve us by providing definition to our lives in some sense, but it also serves us by meeting our essential needs and helping us meet our wants as well, which can actually become needs as we become dependent on infrastructure. So if we focus instead on meeting service as opposed to protecting infrastructure, we can start to think about the risk to infrastructure a little differently. But to do this, we need to grasp how it is that infrastructure works and how this exposes it to risk. Imagine owning a phone in the 1870s or a light bulb before there was no readily accessible, cheap electricity grid, or owning an internal combustion engine before we had a petroleum system capable of extraction, refining, and distribution. Network provides its value to us through network effects. The more of us who use it, the more of infrastructure there is, the more benefit we're able to extract from it. Let's take another example. Imagine going to visit your family. Increasingly, we live further and further away from our family, at least for a part of our lives. So we need to take a plane to go visit them. We need to order tickets online through a vast e-commerce system that communicates with different buildings and different places of the world. This all needs to be powered. There's security along the way. We need to eat. We need fossil fuels and freight support services to accomplish this journey. Now take one type of infrastructure, say communications. Increasingly, all the other types of infrastructure use communications infrastructure, and likewise, communications infrastructure uses others. So infrastructure crosses domains to create an even larger network to give us even larger network effects. This creates a vast web, but what can happen is when one of those infrastructure fails, it can propagate across the network. This happened when that substation failed in New York City, when the levees broke in New Orleans, or when our power lines went down here in Toronto. Now, we can increase our protection. Protection can stop these cascades. If the damage doesn't happen, then the cascade can't occur. But in a changing world with things like climate change and technological uncertainties, it's becoming increasingly harder to know how to build this protection, how to size it, and it's becoming increasingly expensive to do so, such that we're not investing properly. So instead, we can employ resilience thinking, which focuses on the service of infrastructure, which allows us to do protection, but it also allows us to add diversity and redundancy of supply, to add flexibility into our system, or to disperse our vulnerabilities so that they all don't get hit at once. This gives us a larger set of solutions to work from, and it's very useful for dealing with the shocks to our infrastructure. But there's another set of risks, and those risks are associated with what happens when the service we require from our infrastructure changes. When that highway was laid down that I took for my summer vacations, it cost a lot of money. And to do that, they had to think about how big that highway needed to be today, but how big it needed to be for tomorrow. In a world with a changing climate, for example, It's becoming less and less clear what service we'll need from our infrastructure, what climate it'll be subject to, whether we'll be able to use the resources that we've typically used in order to service that infrastructure and service our needs. So how do we act appropriately in the face of this growing uncertainty, both from shocks and from the challenges of unknown service requirements? Again, we could practice protection-only mindset. We could fortify. We could entrench our position and get every last drop out of the market position we're in or whatever other position we're in. But there's no reason to expect that this will be A, affordable, and B, successful. It is likely to fail in the same way that our protection to more conventional shocks has failed. So again, we return to resilience planning and resilience thinking. As we continue to grow in our understanding of how the network of infrastructure works, the same growth and understanding is occurring in other domains. Over the past several years, our understanding of network dynamics in ecosystems and in communities and human systems has been expanding rapidly. And we're also working towards and making progress in expanding our capability to understand the connections between these different types of networks. So if we think about meeting essential services and we have a language that can talk between humans and the natural world and our technologies, then we can increasingly come up with resilient solutions to the risks we face. We've learned two lessons, at least so far, in this endeavor. The first is that if we consider the externalities over the life cycle of our decisions, we can achieve a lot. I remember a few years ago when we did a business case analysis of several alternative energy technologies. We looked at these investments over the life cycle, and we found four things. One, that there were investment opportunities available that were better than conventional investment opportunities. We could reduce greenhouse gas emissions by making these investments. And that we could offset our risks due to the volatile energy markets. And finally, that alternative energy was a way to add diversity of supply or redundancy of supply into an operation that we cared about to achieve enhanced resiliency. That's a win-win-win-win. It's not often we see that sort of wonderful opportunity, but we were able to deal with externalities, the things we don't usually think about, deal with our financial risk, deal with our operational risk, and make a strong investment. The second piece is engagement. We certainly need governments to engage with us about what it is we need from infrastructure, at all levels of government, at all scales of infrastructure. What we need from it now, what our children will need from it in the future. But we also need to engage ourselves with this debate, and we need to engage locally. I remember a few years ago when I was volunteering for this group called Project Neutral. They have the goal to create the first carbon neutral neighborhoods through retrofit. It's an astounding goal, one I think they will eventually reach. What's amazing about this organization and the way it works is that it's all about the people in the neighborhoods. It's all about their interest, their understanding, their social networks. And I was amazed at the creativity, the progress being made. They were asking questions, whether they knew it or not, about what service they needed from infrastructure, what service they'd need from it in the future, what the relationship to infrastructure was. And that was a very encouraging debate. And this is but one example of many, many different types of community activities going on around the world that are struggling with these ideas and coming up with novel solutions. This gives us a very diverse and large set of things to build off of and learn from. And diversity is a key tenet of resilience. And I think that the interaction these people are having with one another, with their infrastructure, asking the questions that really need to be asked of how to make their communities work better, not just in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, mind you, and energy, but in terms of cultural, social, political issues, other environmental issues. These sorts of activities give us the strength and the power to create and find the connections that can truly create a world that can flourish. Thank you.